This is a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.
Good morning, everyone. State Senator Chris Langer from District. Good morning, everyone. State Senator Chris Langer. I'm the majority leader in the Senate this year from District 25 in northern Minnehaha County. We're on our last day to get bills out of chamber, so it'll be a busy day. But it's been a good session so far. I look forward to your questions.
Good morning, everyone. Representative Lee Quam, House Majority Leader, District 21. Been a great session so far. I think we've got some really good things accomplished. We need to keep moving forward. Looking forward to finishing up today. It was crossover day, and we're actually going in early. We're going to start at 11 o'clock. Historically, we talk more than the Senate does, so they, you know, them starting at 1, they'll probably still beat us done. So looking forward to your questions.
Good morning, Representative Arch Beal, District 12. I'm the Assistant Majority Leader in the House, and we have been very busy. A lot of bills got sent to the 41st day yesterday in our committees. Some of them got tabled. We're going to burn daylight today. Thank you.
With this being the crossover day deadline, are there any last-minute bills that you think are important or initiatives that you see coming up today in either chamber?
You know, one of the things that we'll be revisiting today is I think you maybe saw the deaf child initiative that came through yesterday. Didn't have enough votes to meet the two-thirds threshold, so I think that will be reconsidered on the Senate floor today. Other than that, we just have a lot of some work to do, some good bills that are coming through.
I don't know that there's any that have any more magnitude than the other with what we have. We've gotten some of the bigger ones taken care of early on, so I think every bill's important to somebody, and we'll do the best job we can to get it debated and find out which way it ends up.
One of those bills that'll be up on the House today is, I think it's 1245. It's the one that would, it would still require felons to complete probation and parole, but if they don't have their restitution quite paid off. Can you talk a little bit about, I think you both voted differently on that bill. Could you talk a little bit about how you see that legislation and how the debate might go?
Well, that was in State Affairs yesterday, and we really had a good debate on it. I think there's merit on both sides of that, looking at, you know, where we decide when a felon should be able to vote or not. I ended up having broke the tie. It was 6-6 when it came to me, and I felt it deserved to go to the floor to have more discussion to see if somebody wants to amend it further. When it gets to when everything's taken care of except that restitution, sometimes restitution can take a long, long time. And is it right for them to divide, you know, denied their voting rights? I don't know, you know, so we're going to let the whole body take a shot at it and see what they have to say.
You know, and I was probably on the opposite side of that, and I give my leader credit. You know, I mean, it is a issue that deserves some talk. I voted the other way. He voted, put it on the floor. I give him credit for that. Thank you.
Senator Langer, I know the Senate passed the bill that would not allow Board of Regents employees collective bargaining this week, and you talked about the flexibility that that might allow. Can you talk a little bit more about what you're seeing with that flexibility and what changes could possibly happen with the Board of Regents employees with that bill?
Sure, thanks for that question. You know, one of the things that I think is really important for our students is to not only have the intellectual knowledge, but be able to practice that when they get into the workforce. You know, we've had some business leaders and just students themselves concerned about that, being ready for the workforce. So part of the problem with that is the professorial practice. So a lot of times their credentialing doesn't meet the requirements. They might not have a PhD behind their name. They might not have the right things. And so this would just allow the Board of Regents a bit more flexibility as far as, and the university presence as far as who they can hire for professors of practice. You know, I another one of my arguments was the medical school and the law school both function quite well without the collective bargaining. I think it just makes our universities a bit more nimble and adapt to change. And you know, it is an ever-changing market when we're looking at teaching our young people, and a part of the way to keep tuition as low as we possibly can. You know, dollars are tight wherever we look. And so I think this will, you know, it does nothing with the tenure. It does nothing with the practices they've seen in other states. There's no problem with it. Has not affected recruiting or retention, and neither the Board of Regents nor the university presidents have raised any problems or concerns regarding that. So,
can I ask from the House side? I know there's a similar bill. I think has some differences coming up today. I don't think that got recommendation of a committee. What will you be looking at as you consider that bill, or will you wait until it comes over from the Senate?
Well, obviously, we'll see what happens today. If it gets enough votes to get calendared, and then we will have to discuss it. So we'll have to wait and see what happens. Don't know at this point.
Typically, once we get past crossover day, it's all about budget. Can you tell us where we're at with budget numbers and what remains in the next couple of weeks?
Sure, we're getting close, getting a lot closer to what the ongoing numbers and the one-time priorities are. You know, we've had lots of discussions in caucus about where those priorities are. Now it's kind of meshing them with the House's priorities and trying to figure out where we're going to go with that as far as budget. I know appropriators have some final bills today that they're working through and trying to get everything finalized. So there'll still be a lot of ongoing discussions, but I think we're getting close to figuring out each other's priorities.
I would certainly agree with that. Obviously, with coming in the beginning of this week and realizing we had a $10 million hole, we had to fill in the employees' health care. You know, that kind of skewed some of the numbers that we had been working with, so we had to make a quick about face and make some adjustments. So maybe it's taken a little longer than it would have, because we were both, you know, we both had our stuff. We had to make changes. But we're getting close. We're getting close to where we need to be, that's for sure.
If I could follow up on that, the fourth guardrail of the hemp bill is still out there. Where are we at on that? Last I knew, 3.6 from the gov. And am I right? Sub-$1 million potentially is the other side of the argument. Where are we at on hemp?
Well, we are discussing that. As a matter of fact, on Monday, a bunch of us are going to sit down and try to hammer out the differences to hopefully by Monday, we have a number that we're all going to agree on and where we're going to move forward with.
And from the Senate perspective, I'm making sure that happens. I've asked that be put into the bill, the money, the funding for it, because I think I'm not a fan of passing legislation that when we know it's going to cost money, that it doesn't have the money in there. It has an emergency clause anyway, so it would need the 2/3 vote. So it's not as if I'm trying to make it a harder threshold, but I do believe that the money needs to be in the bill, and I think that forces the negotiations to happen as well so that we can come to a number that everyone is comfortable with, at least between the House and the Senate.
I could one more on hemp. Last year, we got to the point where it ended in a veto. Is this bill going forward, and are you anticipating potential resistance if you don't hit that fourth guardrail, $3.6 million? Are you prepared to deal with that?
I don't think it's the governor's intention to veto. I think she's worked hard to set up her guardrails. I think it's fair to say that it's not a priority for her. I mean, you didn't see the funding in her budget, but I think there's, you know, realization that, you know, especially with the CBD oil, there needs to be some, or the CBD products, there needs to be some parameters put around that. And I think she'll, once we can decide where that number is at, I don't think she has any intention of vetoing it.
And I would certainly agree with that. It's just a matter of getting the numbers worked out where we all feel comfortable with it. And like I said, I anticipate that happening on Monday. So.
House Bill 1277, one of the bills dealing with lewd content, revenge pornography, that type of thing. Looks like it's gone through the House, headed over to the Senate. What are discussions? What are the view of that over there so far?
You know, honestly, we have not discussed that at all. We're kind of been concentrating on getting our Senate bills off the floor, so I can't comment on that as far as what the Senate desire is. I'm not even sure what committee that's assigned to yet. So I wish I had an answer, but I do not.
Could either of you comment on the House side of things, how that bill went through and how that discussion went?
Well, there was, you know, when it went through state affairs, it was very late one night, and we decided to make it. There was nobody there in opposition to it, and we decided we wanted to make some phone calls, talk to the Attorney General and everything, make sure everything was fine with it. And so we did, and you know, in our next meeting, we passed it out then, and the bill is fine the way it is. You know, it just wants to very much put a limit on what happens and give, whether it's a man or woman, the opportunity to not get caught up into something that they don't want to. That's really the long and short of it. And it puts parameters out there. And I think it's a pretty good bill.
I guess I could talk about, I don't know if you watched, Senator Heinert had a bill yesterday basically making a charter school, they don't call it that, but kind of a charter school for Native American kids. The gallery was pretty full, there was lots of emotion. I mean, we realized that there's a disconnect, or we haven't done a great job of educating the Native American students, and We just realized we needed to try something different. I think that was the consensus of everyone in the Senate. I think you saw that came out 35-0. Pretty strong vote to head over to the House. So we'll see. You know, we fixed the funding problems as much as we could, as far as, you know, the local school districts and the bonding. There was some concern about how it affected the bonds, but there was an amendment to address that. So there's some great discussion and about that. I think that's a new concept that deserves a chance to move forward.
Can you talk a little bit about maybe how Senator Heinert was able to convince the Senate for that unanimous vote? It's pretty tough to get sometimes.
Yeah, if you saw, he was pretty emotional about that. I think, you know, we just had some good discussions about, even though it might not be perfect and there's going to be some stumbling things that come up, that it was was definitely worthy of at least a trial basis of how that goes, and hopefully there'll be some great successes that come from that. You know, their cultural differences and their style of learning. Hopefully we can address some of those issues and make learning fun for those students and effective.
Okay. Well, good morning. Welcome to the Democrat Leadership Press Conference. I'm Senator Troy Heinert, District 26, and the Senate Minority Leader. With me today is Senator Craig Kennedy from Yankton. We're down, getting close to the end, and the Senate has been doing its business well, I think. Now comes the Appropriations Committee's turn to present us with a budget and revenue projections that we can fund our priorities. For the Senate Democrats, we have said all along that we wanted to follow the law as it pertains to education funding, which means a 2% increase for teachers this year. The leadership, Democratic leadership, had a meeting with Governor Noem on Tuesday. She wanted to hear our priorities. We relayed that message to her and also gave her some ideas where we think the money is available now. So we'll see what goes forward. She indicated to us that she wants to keep education, state employees, and community support providers together. So in our mind, that's a 2% increase across the board for the big three. And that's what we will support. And I will turn it over to Representative Smith.
Representative Jamie Smith, House Minority Leader from Sioux Falls, District 15, here also with Representative Aaron Healy from Sioux Falls. You know, it's been a very busy week in the House, but we have been getting through our calendar. We did better than I anticipated. Today, on crossover day, we have about 16 pieces of legislation that still need to get through and some sort of action taken today to get all those things over to the Senate, if that's the direction that they would go. And so we are gaveling in early today. We're gaveling in at 11 o'clock this morning. You know, I still anticipate it being a very long day, and who knows, there could be things that happen to make that day longer. I'm not sure if we're going to recess, but we will be out of here, and the good news is I know that we're going to get all of our work done. And so that. I'd like Representative Healy actually to share some good news for what the day looks like for us and some successes that we've had this week.
Thank you, Representative Aaron Healy, Sioux Falls, District 14. So we had a number of bills actually make it to the House floor. We are seeing five bills from Democrats today. One of them would revise certain provisions regarding sexual harassment, so we're actually adding interns to those provisions in the statute so they can also
be protected by that
be
law.
Protected by the law. We have House Bill 1228, which would include criteria for deaf and hard of hearing kids. That is my bill. Currently, we are only collecting data for ages 0 to 5, and this bill would increase that to 18 or 21 for special ed kids. We are seeing a bill from Representative McCleary that would permit modification of the term of a perpetual conservation easement after the death of a grantor. House Bill 1245, which would revise certain provisions regarding the voting rights of felony offenders. Now, that bill would allow for felons to have their voting rights back sooner as long as they have completed their parole. And then we're also seeing House Bill 1212 on the floor today, which would add clergy and dental hygienists to the list of mandatory reporters. And that is also a bill that I have brought.
With that, we would entertain any questions.
House Bill 1245 passed out of House State Affairs, as just mentioned. Can you talk about the strategy inside of that meeting, and how y'all ended up getting it on the House floor, and why this bill is you see this bill as important?
Well, you know, voter rights are very important, and I think Representative Sullivan did an excellent job in painting the picture of recidivism rates and how we can try to help people be successful when they re-enter society. And I think the stats were excellent indicators of what this could look like in the state of South Dakota. I think you're referring to the fact that when the bill came to the committee, it also asked that just as soon as you'd done your time, in prison, then we would restore those rights. And it definitely felt like that the committee wasn't going there through the questioning and discussion. But through the discussion, it was quite clear that there was a concern about people that had done their time, parole, and probation, but still perhaps had restitution obligations that were not met. And in doing so, we did have that amendment ready. Representative Sullivan anticipated that would be a place that perhaps people might find more agreement. And so when it was clear to us on the committee that that's the direction it was going, we did offer that amendment, which then allowed another discussion to take place. And I guess one of the major points that I want to say that I really, and I thought it was Representative Dennard that brought it up, was if you're a family with good financial means, you can pay that restitution off and you're able to vote. But if you're a person with lower socioeconomics from that part of our society and you just don't have money, you could be locked into a payment schedule for the rest of your life and still never have that opportunity to vote again. And I do think that there's a real willingness for people today to hear that on the floor and try to understand that and wrap their head around that concept. And I believe that is ultimately very unfair. And I think that we have an opportunity here to do something right here today. So it'll be interesting to see how it goes.
I know there was some slow scheduling of some bills in committee with, you know, five bills from Democrats coming up on the last day. Does that make it hard? Was that frustrating? And what have your actions been to kind of deal with that?
The actions have been that of being very persistent. Representative Healy right next to me is very persistent and diligent. In fact, that Mike, you know, reminding me as leader, my bill's not scheduled yet. My bill's not scheduled yet. My bill's not scheduled yet. We refer to that question. We talk to the different people in leadership saying, well, can we please schedule our bill? Can we please schedule our bill? And we went down that path, and we had to go different directions sometimes. Eventually, we were successful in getting everything, out there later than perhaps we wanted to, and they drug on. And like one of the comments on I believe we were just talking about 1245 was, you know, it takes a little more time maybe to understand this and work through this. Well, we have a day here, you know, to really come up with some more information. It doesn't give us the time that other bills have been afforded to try to work through some of their issues. And to try to have that opportunity to understand those. And so that is frustrating. And our bills were dropped at the same time other people's bills were dropped. And they sat there and waiting. To the positive, we all got our hearing. We all got them done. And
I would also like to add that four of the five bills, I'm not quite sure about Representative Cleary's, were heard just yesterday.
Typically, after crossover day, everything moves to appropriations. You've talked about that, but how's the appropriations process going right now? House and Senate, are you coalescing around that? And then I want to follow up with funding for hemp.
Sure. I would just say that we concur with what everything that Senator Heinert said today. We are exactly, the House is on the same page with the Senate as far as the House Democrats and Senate Democrats. We've been united on that from the beginning, and we stand united on that we will follow the law. They have a lot of work to do, and there's no denying that it's really a difficult job. And so we just will keep working to make sure that our priorities are known. The communication has been, I'm going to say, better this year than last year. I think you'd agree with me on that, Senator. Anything you'd like to add to that?
Well, you know, as far as the appropriations process, we believe that the money that would fund our priorities is already there. The number that Appropriations Committee has adopted is less than what the LRC estimates are. And those are, the LRC estimates, you know, those people work for us, and they're the ones that are saying, this is the money that's available. We believe that to be accurate. Senator Kennedy brought up a really good point in caucus yesterday. Maybe he could share that with you.
I agree with what Senator Heiner just said, and my thought is, and what I expressed to our appropriators was this: we're talking about budgeting. And so whenever you do a budget, it's inherently an estimation or projection or prediction of what you think is going to happen. And it seems to me that if our own LRC staff has told us that we can anticipate revenues at a certain level, which is higher than what the Appropriations Committee is currently working from, we should perhaps use those numbers as the basis on which we try to set our budget, which is our anticipated expenditure over the fiscal year of 2021, and that's what we're talking about here. If for some reason it turns out that revenues aren't as good as what LRC has projected them to be, we can always adjust, because that's what happens, at least in my experience in business. The budget, it is not the end of the world. It's an idea, it's a suggestion, it's a goal, but it's adjustable and it's adaptable. And so I think if you look back historically, at least since I've been here, and I've only been here, this is my fourth year, but every year we've in fact turned money back that was budgeted but not spent. So even using conservative budgeting numbers in the past, we've underspent what was anticipated. So my thought is that we've probably got the ability to budget for 2% for teachers, for care providers, for state employees, and that we should do that. And then we'll see what happens when fiscal 21 gets here.
The follow-up on that then is the hemp bill. The fourth guardrail that Governor Noem proposed is funding for anything related to passage of the hemp bill. Estimates vary from, I think, $1 million is what some lawmakers have tossed around, 3.6 from Governor Noem. Where do you think we land?
Well, where we land will be between the Appropriations Committee and the governor's office. I think what we have said all along is that 3.6 is an inflated number. So I don't know if she is drawing a hard line on 3.6. You know, I guess that is her prerogative. We don't believe that it's going to cost that much. I think the estimates, you know, some have said even 700,000. So that's kind of where we're going into it. That's what we want to see in the budget, because then we can use that money for the priorities that we just talked about.
Well, we can't let you leave without talking about your bill yesterday on the school.
Yes.
Just kind of a little bit about bringing that together and then getting the unanimous vote yesterday.
You know, honestly, I was, obviously, I'm extremely pleased and blessed that this was able to come out of the Senate. When we were going through the vote, Senator Kennedy leaned over me and goes, "This is going to be unanimous." And that's when it was hitting me that what we were doing. And last night, in talking with the groups who had brought this forward and knowing the work that went into it, you know, not only with the DOE and the governor's office and the legislature and the Senate Ed Committee, they did a great job. But the parents and families and schools that we talked to, what we did yesterday is, I think that's the first time a government since the boarding school era has acknowledged that we have an opportunity to right the wrong of what was forced on Native people in the late 1800s. You know, that was huge. And then to come out 35-0 was so emotional for a lot of people. You know, I couldn't ask for a better outcome. Obviously, we'll have some work to do in the House to, you know, educate our colleagues of why this is important. But the bigger work is when we get home and these schools get established, what do we do that works for kids? And that's, this bill gives us that opportunity, and we'll do a good job with it.
Just as a little follow-up, does this bill, and if it does, how would it affect the current Peer Indian Learning Center school right here in Peer?
So, great question. Peer Indian Learning Center is actually federally funded. It's funded through the BIE. But hopefully this model, we could carry that to Peer Indian Learning Center. I've been out there. I know some of the kids that are there, and what a great opportunity for them if we can help have better outcomes for them in a culturally relevant manner.
I know the Senate passed a bill that would not allow collective bargaining by employees of the Board of Regents this week, and there's a similar bill, slightly different, in the House that looks like it might come up, but didn't have the support of the committee. I wonder if you could tell me a little bit about what you see changes happening as a result if that does end up getting passed.
I would say, we're changing how universities operate, with their staff and, who they have in employment, which could then change, the outcome of the students who attend these universities. For the life of me, I can't figure out why there's been this big attack on unions in South Dakota. Because for a long time, I think unions in South Dakota have done really good things for worker protections and worker rights and producing good products, whether that's at a university system or in the construction field. It's an important piece of making sure that we have the people in the right place to do the job we are asking them to in a safe and non-political manner. The collective bargaining agreements that unions create are for the good of all workers. And we heard testimony that, well, not very many Regents employees are members. Well, they're still getting those benefits of the work that those, of the union members. So I would like to have that conversation, as somebody who comes from family with union workers, those were important.
I just add one thing, and I tried to bring this out in the committee hearing on this bill. I think the other thing that this will change potentially is the morale of the faculty members at the universities. I've had experience working with COHE members and with non-COHE faculty members when they've had issues with administration. And the thing that COHE brought to these faculty was a place where they felt they could be heard, they could be listened to, and they could get advice on what they should do. That's going to go away. And the faculty members will all be pretty much on their own. And I fear that that's going to be a little bit intimidating to faculty, and it may affect our ability to recruit and retain high-quality faculty at our universities, and I'm a little concerned about that.
I'm wondering if you could tell me a little bit about your bill that adds clergy to the list of, and dental hygienists to the list of mandatory reporters, what that would affect, and if that would affect confession.
Yes, so House Bill 1212 would add dental hygienists and clergy. clergy to the list of mandatory reporters. Both professions have come forward and asked to be added. Certain individuals within different denominations. The United Methodist Church is the church that approached me last year, and we tried to pass this through. It lost by one vote on the House floor. So this year, the dental hygienists have also asked to be added. There, I believe, are 38 states that include dental hygienists. Our state only includes dentists. So right now, if a dental hygienist is seeing signs of abuse when they're cleaning a child's teeth, they have to pull in that dentist to make that phone call for them. This would take out the middleman for them. The concern with this bill is the clergy. So as written, the bill did not include any exemption, but getting out of committee yesterday, we did amend the bill, which I had ready prior to that committee hearing, so we can have a religious privilege exemption. What that means is if you are in the sacrament of confession or if you are receiving spiritual advice from a pastor and you are to admit that you have been abused and you are a minor, that pastor does not have to report that abuse. But as far as I understand it, they're going to try their hardest to pull that person out of confession and get that that confession so they can make that report. The concern yesterday with the bill as written prior to the amendment was that we are violating pastors' rights to have that religious relationship with members of their congregation. And I want to respect the sacrament of confession. The main goal here is to get all members of the clergy trained so they know how to see, how to detect child abuse, and they know the right steps to report that abuse. There are a lot of churches here in our state that don't have a policy surrounding what to do when they come across a situation like this.
Anything you want to add? No. Thank you for joining us. Have a good weekend.
Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you.
Weren't even on.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.